Thanks, Randy. Randy, actually, I forgot one of the key parts of the evening is that I've heard that when it's over, there will be snacks. So, you know, I'm going to be here till the end. That's all I'm saying. Well, good morning, everyone. For those of you that I haven't had a chance to meet before, my name is Mike King, and I have the privilege as senior pastor here of leading just really a tremendous group of staff and pastors and lay leaders who make what we do here at the church possible. And this morning, we're continuing on in a teaching series that we started last week that we're calling Greater Than. And basically what we're doing in this series is we're going back to the book of Psalms, which is found in the Old Testament. And it's kind of a collection of the ancient poems and songs that the people of Israel used as part of their worship life together. So we're going back, we're looking at these ancient poems and songs, and we're just sort of asking the question, what do these tell us about us? What can these old songs, what can they tell us about God and who he is and how he wants to continue to be at work in our life? So each week we're just kind of picking one of the psalms and we're digging into it to see the lessons that it might say to us today. So to get started this morning, I'd like to invite you to turn to the 121st Psalm. If it would help you for any reason, there's some red Bibles in the seats in front of you, and you can grab one of those and kind of head to the page number that's there on the screen so that you can get to the same page, literally, that we can all be on. But as you're turning there, let me kind of explain to you how this psalm was used as part of the worship life of Israel. So many of you guys know this, but the first few books of the Old Testament tell the story about how God saw that the humanity that he's made because of mankind's sin was broken. And he didn't want it to stay that way, so he picked one group, the people of Israel, and began to work through them to share his message of love and grace and hope and forgiveness with the whole world. So in the book of Exodus, we read how he brings them out of slavery in Egypt, and he brings them to this land that he had promised to give them, and that's going to be kind of their home base of operations. And as they prepare to go into the land, he gives them some rules and laws and guidelines that they need to follow as they're there in that land. And some of those guidelines involved a calendar. There were a number of different times throughout the year where the people of Israel were called to come together to celebrate, to kind of enjoy these holidays together. And on these holidays, they were called to come together and do some things that really helped them remember who God was and what it was that God had done for them. And now, obviously, just like in our country today, people are spread out all over, but during these particular festivals, the people who lived outside were kind of called to travel in and come together. So once the city of Jerusalem was set up as the capital of Israel and the temple was built there, it just made sense that that would be the place where people would gather for these festivals. So several times a year, a lot of the people from Israel, they would literally travel to Jerusalem to get there. And turns out, as they traveled, they sang. Right? Just like maybe we, when we're on road trips, we've got family songs, we sing along with the radio. They had songs that they sang as they were traveling. So, you know, in the book of Psalms, from about Psalm 120 to Psalm 134 or 35, you have this group of songs that really people think were sung as people were traveling to Jerusalem for these festivals. And now, to get to Jerusalem, you have to actually go up into the mountains because it's kind of at some elevation. So you literally have to ascend the mountains to get there. So they call this particular group of songs the Songs of Ascent, because people would sing them while they were ascending up the mountain. And it turns out that Psalm 121 is one of those. It's one of the songs that people would sing as they were traveling there. So it's not a surprise as you read through it that some of the details that show up in the psalm, it's pretty easy to see. Oh, yeah, this is talking about somebody who's traveling, who's kind of on a road trip. But as you dig a little deeper and as you read into it, you realize it's not just talking about how God protects travelers. It's really talking about how God is with all of us in whatever journey we may be going on in life. Wherever we're going, whether it's physically or spiritually, emotionally, God is with us wherever we go. And God realizes that on these journeys that we're on, there are some things out there that can be dangerous. But the psalm reminds us that God is greater than our fears. Right? That's what we're looking at today. You know, really the book of Psalms as a whole, it's really about how God is greater than all of the different things that we struggle with in life. But this one in particular talks about how God is greater than the fears that we may face. And, you know, talking about fears just seemed like a good thing to do as a part of this series, because we live in a world where there are some things that we legitimately should be concerned about. We legitimately should be afraid of. You know, it's ironic. A couple of weeks ago, I had a chance. I was traveling, and when I was on the plane, I was kind of doing some work on the sermon, doing some reading and research, and I came across this article in Time magazine that talks about how this generation of teenagers that are kind of coming through high school right now, more than any other generation that we know of, they suffer more with anxiety and worry and fear than anyone we've ever seen. Look at this quote from Time that says this. It's describing what life is like for teenagers today. It says, remember, they are the post-9/11 generation. They're raised in an era of economic and national insecurity. And think about what your school experience would have been like if this was you. They have never known a time when terrorism and school shootings weren't the norm. They grew up watching their parents weather a severe recession, and perhaps most important, they hit puberty at a time when technology and social media were transforming society. And Time goes on to say that somewhere around 30% of teenage girls and 20% of teenage boys suffer with anxiety disorders, because that's just the level of fear in the world that this next generation lives in. And again, as I said, it's ironic. I wrote this a couple of weeks ago, and it talks about, in that quote, it talks about school shootings, and then unfortunately, there's another mass school shooting this week. That's just part of what we deal with in the world today. You know, it's interesting, just in the last few days since that school shooting, if you go on social media, a lot of high school students now are posting pictures of themselves, kind of, it's sort of a play off the Me Too movement. It just has a picture, they're holding up a sign that says, "Me next?" question mark. Right, it just sort of points out the level of fear that people live with. Is this going to happen in my hometown? Is this going to happen in my school next? So teenagers obviously deal with this tension and anxiety that's well documented, but as adults, we're not that far behind them, right? I mean, there's a lot of things in our world that can cause us to worry. You pick the news, turn the news on, you got your pick of things to be scared about. You know, it's a bad flu season. Okay, well, does that mean the super flu is coming and there's going to be a pandemic that wipes us all out? You know, as parents, you know, it's just a different experience now when you put your kids on the bus to send them to school and think, you know, is this going to be the day where something happens and they don't come home? I was talking to a friend of mine this morning whose wife has taught in schools for years, and she said, you know, it's just different these days. Now, when the fire alarm goes off, my first thought isn't, oh, I wonder if it's a fire drill. My first thought now when the fire alarm goes off is, do we have an active shooter in our school? Is this a drill or is this really something to be afraid of? Right? The world has just changed. And it's not just here in our, you know, in our country we have things to worry about, right? There's stuff all around the world with tension with other countries. You know, a lot of us remember what happened, in Hawaii a couple of weeks ago. You know, some government employee hits the wrong button and sends out this warning to everybody in the islands that a ballistic nuclear missile is inbound and they need to take cover. And of course, people believed it. Because for months, Kim Jong-un has been talking about how he's got missiles that can hit the islands and can hit the West Coast now. And tension has been rising. So it's very plausible, right, that something like that could happen. And it's heartbreaking. You kind of read some of the stories that came out in the news after that, of the phone calls that parents made, trying to figure out if their kids were all right. Of text messages, right, a husband who's just panicked that his wife is going to die alone on the island with no one to console her because he's traveling. Right, we live in a world where it doesn't take much for all the fear that we have just below the surface to kind of bubble up and to start impacting what we think and what we do. And that's why I'm so grateful for Psalms like this, that God's word still speaks to this world powerfully today, to the fears that we experience, the anxieties that we experience in this world today. Because again, I think one of the messages that we see in this psalm in particular is that, yeah, there is a lot to be afraid of, but we don't have to let our fears dominate us. We don't have to let our fears control us. While there are things that we've got to be aware of and kind of plan for, we also need to remember that God is with us, that God is greater than our fears, and then when we face these things in our world, he is right there with us. So here's what I want to do to get started. We're going to jump into Psalm 121, and it's actually not a very long poem at all. It's just 8 verses long. So what I'm going to do is we're going to put the text of the poem as a whole up on the screen behind me. And I just want to invite you to read this poem out loud with me. I kind of put one version up here on the screen because I know we use different translations, but at least this way we can all say the same words at the same time. But as we read it out loud, let's just hear what it has to say as a whole. And then we're just going to walk through the poem a verse at a time and sort of see how it addresses this issue of fears. So if you would you read with me? It says, "I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. So like I said, it's not a long psalm, but one of the things that I think you notice when you read it, especially when you read it out loud, is you notice that there's a couple of phrases that just seem to get repeated over and over again. Like I counted five different times in this poem, you read that God is watching over us, right? The Lord, his name shows up a lot too. The Lord is watching over us. And when you have a poem that's this short, and there's a phrase like that that gets repeated over and over and over and over again, it's like the poet is there with flares just trying to get your attention and saying, this is my big idea. This is the main idea I want you to take away as you read this. What you need to remember is that in the midst of our fears, God is not absent, right? God is right there with us. God is watching over us. And now, as we start to walk through this poem verse by verse, kind of an interesting thing happens. One of the things I think you see when you pay attention to it is there's kind of two different people speaking in this verse. The first couple of verses, there's somebody speaking. It's actually the person who's going to be traveling. Maybe he's on the journey. He uses first-person language, I, me, that kind of thing. And then starting in verse 3, the language changes. Someone else is speaking, and he's talking to the traveler. He says, you know, he'll keep you from all harm. And in the first part, you know, the guy kind of brings up his fears that he has. And in the second part, the person's trying to address them. So when you start out in verse 1, you see this. It says, I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? So again, right, as we read through this, one of the things that you notice is that some of the language is pretty specific to travel in first century Israel. You see that what's happening here is somebody's actually describing the fears they have that they'll experience as they go along the journey. And at this point, the guy's probably nearing the city of Jerusalem, and he sees the mountains up there. And something about seeing the mountains kind of inspires some fear to grow in him. And he's like, you know, I lift up my eyes to the mountains, and he asks the question, where's my help going to come from? And if you stop and think about it, like, it was a dangerous world to travel in that day. Like, the mountains in particular were places where you could get robbed. I mean, if you're familiar with Jesus' story of the Good Samaritan, that story starts out where a man is traveling through the mountains right around the city of Jerusalem, and he's set upon by bandits, and he's beaten, and he's left for dead. So there's some real fears that are involved just in travel for your own personal safety. So that's part of why he's calling this out. He says, you know, I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where did my help come from? He's scared. But I think one of the other reasons that travel in the mountains is kind of difficult is, well, I mean, they're mountains, right? They're big. It's hard. It takes energy to climb up the mountain. And you can almost imagine what this man's experience has been like. You know, put yourself in their shoes. This man or this woman, they're traveling to Jerusalem for the festival. Maybe they live far away. They're in the northern part of Israel, and they've spent 2 or 3 days walking already. So they're getting tired. They're tired of traveling, and they're getting closer to Jerusalem, and they look up, and they realize, oh my gosh, it is all uphill from here, right? Where is my strength going to come from? It actually reminds me of the one and only time that I ran a 15K race, the Tulsa Run. So 15K is like 8-9 miles, something like that. And I remember one time we were living in Tulsa, and Martha said, hey, wouldn't it be fun to run the Tulsa Run together? Now, I'm not the kind of person that typically uses the word fun and run in the same sentence. But I thought, you know, this would be a good thing to do together. So we kind of did some training. And I'd never run that far in one stretch in my life. So we're going along, and I feel like I'm plugging along pretty good for the first 8 miles. You know, I actually didn't stop. I'd never run that far without stopping in my whole life, and I'm feeling pretty good about myself. And then the course, the last mile kind of turns, and you come off Riverside Drive, and you're heading towards downtown Tulsa. And I looked up, and I realized, oh, no. The entire last race is uphill. And this, like, I'm ready to go home now. Anything left in the tank. And I just thought, what kind of evil, twisted, demonic-inspired person designed this race course that you end that way? And to a certain extent, I almost wonder if this is what this guy's feeling like. He's already come so far. And then he's like, I got to go up in the mountains now? Where am I? I don't have the strength to keep going. And it's dangerous up there. Where's the strength to face this? Where does the courage to face this? Where is my help really going to come from? And then in verse 2, it's like he catches himself and he answers his own question. He says, my help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Right? He says, okay, I need some help. Where's it come from? My help comes from the Lord. And then he throws this really interesting little phrase in there. He's the maker of heaven and earth. Right? And I think that communicates something to us. It's like the guy looks at the mountains, he realizes there's danger, he realizes that he needs some strength. He says, where's my help going to come from? He says, oh yeah, the guy who made that mountain is right there waiting to help me. So whatever danger I may face in that mountain, whatever strength I need to get up there, it probably doesn't compare to the strength and the courage of the person who's right there with me waiting to help me. Right? That's an encouraging thought for him as he remembers that. It kind of reminds him of a story. I have no idea if this is a true story or not, but we'll just pretend like it is for the sake of example. So this guy's on a cross-country flight. He's working on the plane. He's, you know, got Microsoft Word open. He's typing. He's got some big project report, something going on for work. And like a lot of us, he is probably not hitting save as often as he should. And as he's there typing, all of a sudden, this screen comes up. Okay, how many of you have ever seen this screen before? Right? You just sense a bodily sense of panic comes into me whenever this comes up. So he is freaking out, right? Because all the work that he's done, he's going to land, and he's got to go to the meeting. And if he doesn't have this, what's going to happen? And the guy next to him kind of taps him on the shoulder, says, "Hey, I see you're having some problems with Microsoft Word. I wonder if I could help. My name is Bill Gates. Like, I created Microsoft Word. I may know somebody. Let me make a call, right? I've got a guy who maybe knows a couple of tricks and tips that can help you with that." And obviously, it would change the person's perspective, right? If you're facing a problem and you realize that the person who created the thing you've got the problem with is right there next to you, it kind of probably gives you a little bit more sense of confidence, like, okay, maybe all is not lost. Maybe there's something that can be salvaged from this. So that's what he's remembering. He remembers that God is there with him, the maker of heaven and earth. And again, at this point, the speaker changes. So now it's not the traveler speaking anymore. It's someone else. And what you see in the next six verses is somebody who kind of looks ahead and envisions, okay, what are the different dangers that you're going to face? And then gives some encouragement about how God will be with them in that. So it all starts, you get to verse 3, and he says, "He will not let your foot slip." Okay, now just a question for you guys. How many of you have ever been hiking before? Okay, it's not a trick question. It's Oregon. I kind of expected to see a lot of hands go up. Well, if you've ever been hiking in Oregon, one of the other things that I've noticed in Oregon is that it is occasionally wet here. So it's probably not too much of a stretch to imagine if you've hiked in Oregon, you've had the experience where your foot has slipped out from under you, right? It's not a pleasant experience. You can fall. And that's one of the things. There were some real dangers for people who were traveling to Jerusalem at the time. It was not always an easy road. There are places where you could slip and fall and break a leg or fall into a ravine, right? There's some real dangers there. And the speaker recognizes that. He's like, look, it's a dangerous road, so let's just call a spade. There's some dangers there, but you need to remember, God won't let your foot slip, right? There's some dangers that you have to face, but you won't be alone. He's not going to let your foot slip. He's going to be right there with you. And then he kind of keeps going, and this is where he starts to introduce this idea that God will be watching over us, this phrase that comes up over and over again in the next few verses. So you go back to verse 3, and he says, "He will not let your foot slip. In fact, he who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep." Right? Unlike the night watchman at the bank or somebody there at the store, God is not going to fall asleep on the job. Right? That's one of the benefits of being God, is that you don't need to take naps, right? So we can have the confidence that whatever is going on, he's always attentive. He's always watching. There's not a nap he needs to take or more pressing business that's going to come and pull his focus and attention away from us. He says, no, he doesn't slumber or sleep. As you travel through these dangerous things, he's always with you. He's always there and always looking out for you. And then you get to verses 5 and 6, and this is my very favorite part of the poem, where it says this. He says, "The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night." Right, so God's there. He's with you as you travel. The sun's not going to harm you. The moon's not going to harm you. Now, the shade at your right hand, like what does all that stuff even mean? Well, here's the best way that I know how to make sense of that. So remember, for these psalms, these songs of ascent, people are singing these while they are traveling to Jerusalem. Well, Jerusalem is in kind of the southern part of Israel. So an awful lot of the people who had to get there lived up in the north, right? Galilee, where Jesus grew up, for example, was in the northern part of the country. So if you're traveling from north to south, the morning sun is going to be on your left side, because that's the east where the sun rises. The morning sun, not that big of a deal. Now, in the Middle East, that means that the afternoon sun is going to be on your right side. And the sun in the Middle East is no joke in the afternoon, right? It bakes the land. It is brutal and hot and oppressive. I mean, it's the desert. It's the Middle East, after all. There's not a lot of trees along the route. There's not a lot of shade along the route. So think about how it would change your experience as a traveler if you're walking, and to the right side of you, you've got somebody really big and tall that's basically blocking the sun, right? If I got to make this journey, I'm going to call Brian Shout, our college pastor, and say, "Brian, come back, and I want you to be on the right side of me, okay?" Because if you think about it, they're gonna take the heat of the day off of you. They're gonna be your shade at your right hand. They're gonna take the brunt of that. And that's what this poem is saying. That's what God does for us. He doesn't just watch over us from a distance. He is right there next to us, standing between us and the sun. And again, while that's a benefit to us, just think about what that means for God. It means he's the one who's kind of taking the punishing heat. He's the one who's getting the worst of the environment, the worst of the situation, so that we can be safe, so that we can be protected, so that we can keep going on the journey. I think that's what it's getting at when he says he's your shade at your right hand. So that the sun won't harm you by day because God is right there next to you, and the moon won't harm you at night. Now, I don't know about you all, but I'm not too worried about the moon most days. You know, it's not like you get moonburn because the moon is too bright or anything like that. So you do stop and wonder, why does he even throw this in? Well, again, like in some places today, there were a lot of superstitions back in the day about the moon. You know, the moon, the full moon was sort of a sign of evil and a bad omen and all of that. Now, I don't think any of that is true. The moon is just the moon. But it's almost like the poet recognizes that that's sort of an idea that's prevalent in the world around him. He says, look, the sun won't harm you by day, and the moon's not going to harm you at night. If you hold on to those superstitions and think there's something sort of dark and dangerous about the moon, that's not going to harm you either. God's got your back both day and night. He's right there with you, so the sun is not going to harm you, and the moon is not going to harm you. And then you get to the last couple verses of this poem, 7 and 8, and it's just so incredible what the poet does here. Because up until this point, he's kind of been talking about what happens on the journey. God's with us on the journey. But here, it's like he sort of broadens the scope of what he's talking about. And instead of just talking about being on this little road trip with God together, he talks about how this really extends to every area of our life that we can imagine. So look what it says in verse 7. It says, the Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going both now and forevermore. Right? He's not just talking about these few days that you're traveling. Instead, he's talking about the whole of life. And it's really the whole of life that's wrapped up in that phrase coming and going. Like that was sort of a common expression in the day that described people's 9-to-5, their daily life. Because again, think about what daily life was like for people who lived in cities back then. Cities, they just looked a lot different than they do today. They're really close in. People were packed in together because the city had to have a wall around it. That was your main protection against enemies and armies that would come. So people lived in the city. But for most people, their 9-to-5 happened outside those city walls, in the fields, in the shops, in the things that were there around them. And so what you would do every morning is you would go from the city. And in the evening, you would come back to the city. So coming and going was this sort of picture of all the other things that we do in our lives. Just the normal things that we do as we go to the work, as we go to store, as we interact with friends and neighbors. That's what the poet is talking about here. He's sort of expanding the areas in which God is with us and protecting us from what we do just as we travel to what we do all through the course of our life, right? He's with us in our comings and our goings, and it's not just right now. It's forevermore, right? It's not just the steps that you take today. It's the steps that you take every day, and it's the eternity that we can spend with God because of what he did for us in Christ. You know, we had an interesting morning this morning. It kind of wasn't what we expected. We got news that Martha's grandmother passed away. And we knew it was coming. You know, she's in her 90s. She's been on hospice for several weeks. She was diagnosed with cancer a while back, and the treatment didn't work. So when the cancer came back, she just said, you know, I've lived a good life. I don't want to treat it again. So we've kind of known that was coming. But it was really beautiful. Her mom wrote, of her 6 adult kids, 5 of them are still alive. They were all able to be there with her at the end, holding her hand, praying with her, and just sort of reading scripture to her. Grandma Steen was a woman of deep, deep faith. And as I was driving in today, you know, we were talking some about the plans and everything this morning. As I was driving in today, just thinking about that picture, you know, what verses would you read to somebody as they lay there and their life is ending? And I thought, well, you know, I'm going to be preaching about Psalm 21, and I'm like, this is what I would have said, right? The Lord will watch over you. He will watch over your comings and your goings, both now and forevermore, right? Those of us, we fear things in this world, and sometimes we fear things for the life to come and the world to come, but the power and presence of God can be with us in all of those areas. He watches over our life, both now and forevermore. So what do we do with this? How do we take this idea, this truth that God is with us, that we don't have to be mastered by our fears, and how do we put that into practice in our lives? Well, again, the particulars of our life are not the particulars of this guy's situation. I'm guessing that most of us don't worry about being robbed by bandits on the way to work, or, you know, getting a really bad sunburn or slipping and falling. But we do live in a world where there are legitimate things to be aware of and be afraid of. So there's some parallels there that we can build on. And to start, let me try to tell you what I think this poem is not saying. Right? It's not an appropriate application of this truth to say, well, if you put your trust and faith in Jesus Christ, you'll never be afraid, you'll never experience anxiety, you'll never worry. Right? Those are human emotions, and those emotions are going to come whether we've put our trust and faith in God or not. I know lots and lots of devoted followers of Jesus who at times have wrestled with genuine fear or worry or anxiety. Right? I know lots of genuine followers of Jesus who go see godly Christian counselors, right? And they get help with professionals or with prescriptions. And I say thank God for every one of those things. Those are agents of God's healing and his grace in our life. But the very fact that even people who are wholeheartedly following Jesus that continue at times to deal with worry and anxiety and fear, it just shows us that's a constant part of our lives today. That's just part of the world that we live in. So if we experience those things, it's not a reflection of like, well, my faith isn't strong enough, or maybe my relationship with God's not what it's supposed to be. No, those things are going to come whether we want them to or not. The question is, what do we do when they come? And I think that's the beautiful truth that we see here in this psalm, is that when worry comes, when anxiety comes, when fear comes, and it will, we don't have to be paralyzed by those things. We don't have to give in to despair and think there's no way this can ever change. I'm never going to get over this. Instead, we can remember that in the very midst of our fears, God is with us. And he's not at a distance off somewhere. He is right here with us. He is at our right hand, following with us and providing us his love and his strength and his encouragement. And like I said, he's willing to do that. He's actually willing to step in between us and the sun. And as I was really preparing this week, I was really just struck by that image. And the more I thought about it, the more I thought, you know, that's kind of an interesting way to describe what God does for all of us when we put our trust and faith in the person of Jesus Christ. Right? It's like God somehow, through Jesus, steps in between us and the sun. Right? So if you're here this morning, and you've never put your trust and faith in Jesus, you've never explored that, you don't know what it's like to have God show up and stand between you and your fears, to stand between you and your worries, to stand between you and your sins and the failures that mark your life, to stand between you and all of the things that weigh you down and make you think that your future is locked into a path. If you've never had that experience, that's what God offers us every single day. Right? Every single one of us, we are more broken than we are ever going to know, but we are more loved by God than we can ever imagine. And every day, he stands there waiting. It's like God's just waiting to come down and get between us and the sun if we would just stop and accept the offer of love and grace and forgiveness that he gives us. So if you're here this morning and you've never experienced that, like today could be the day when you make that choice. And there's a number of ways that you can do that. If you came with a friend, or if somebody brought you to church this morning, I would encourage you, just talk with them. Say, hey, I'm really thinking about letting God have a bigger role in my life. What's your story? Have them share with you how God has made a difference to them. And you can talk about some next steps to take. Or if it would be more helpful to you, as we leave in just a moment, you can go out those doors, you can take a right. We have some folks down in the prayer room that would love to pray with you. Maybe you just want to pray because you've got something you're worried about or you're anxious about or you're fearful of, and you just want somebody else to hear you out and pray with you and speak some words of encouragement to you. We would consider it a privilege to do that there. Or maybe you can talk with them about what it looks like to really open yourself up in trust and faith and believe that Jesus is who he says he is and can do for you what he says he can do. We'd love to talk with you about that. Or of course, you can just talk to God about that too. That's one of the beautiful things about prayer. You don't have to go through somebody else. You can just invite him in. And if you do any of those things today and move closer to God, just don't leave without talking to somebody about that so that we can talk about some next steps that you can take to really get started well in this new chapter that you're entering into with God. But as we close this morning, here's what I want to do. We're going to close with a challenge and then kind of a blessing for you as you go. So the challenge is this. I want to encourage you this week to start the process of memorizing Psalm 121. If you don't memorize things a lot, I know you can do it because we all have song lyrics rattling around in our head that we wish we could get rid of, and this was a song. But if it's a practice you've never done, this is what I would encourage you to do. Right? I just printed it up this week and stuck it on a 3x5 card. Because if something is smaller than a 3x5 card, I lose it. And if it's bigger than a 3x5 card, I just ignore it. So that's kind of the only way I operate and get things done. But just print it up, and then you can carry it with you, right? You can tape it there in the mirror in the morning and try to repeat it as you go. You can keep it in your car so that if you're stuck at a red light, you can run through it. But there's real power in memorizing God's word, and especially I think there's real power in knowing the words to this psalm. Because if you've got this tucked in your back pocket, think about what you can do then in those moments when the fear starts building up, when the worry starts building up, and the anxiety starts building up. You can pull this out and say, no. I know those things are real in the world, but God is watching over me. He will guard my life. He will watch over my comings and goings now and forevermore. You can use these words as a way to remind you and ground yourself in the truth that God is with us. There's power in being able to do that. As we prepare to go, this is what we're going to do. In just a minute, I'm going to offer a really brief prayer for you all. And then I'm going to invite you to stand. And as a sort of a blessing, as a benediction as you go, I just want to say the words of this psalm over you as a blessing. And if you want to, here's what I want to invite you to do as we do that. I just want you to bring to the forefront of your mind whatever fear or worry or anxiety you may be dealing with today. And just kind of hold that in your mind. And as you hear the words of these psalms, just sort of imagine those words confronting that fear head on and putting it in its place. And if you want to, as you stand, you can even open up your hands as a way of saying, kind of physically demonstrating with your body, okay, God, the fear that I have, I want to release that to you. And instead, I want to receive from you the assurance that you're with me, your grace, your comfort, your power. So let's pray, and then I'll have you stand and we'll do that. God, thank you for the opportunity to be here together today. Thank you that even though we live in a world where there legitimately are things to be afraid of, that we legitimately need to be careful about, right? We can't just say, well, God's with me. I'm going to drive 100 miles an hour down Highway 20 and just trust that he's watching over my life. I mean, we can't be dumb about things. But God, we also don't have to just be paralyzed by our fears and all the things around us that could possibly go wrong. So for each of us, Lord, there's a lot of people in this room this morning, and we experience fear and worry and anxiety in very different ways. But you have the amazing ability, through the power of your Holy Spirit, to speak to each human heart and each human mind. So I ask, God, that you would do that. Through the power of your Spirit, through the power of your word, help us find comfort in the midst of our fears so that we can continue on in the journey. We can just continue to hand those things over to you and trust that you will take care of them as you take care of us, and then allow us, God, to keep moving forward in a life that pleases you. We're grateful for your love. Amen. So if you would, to prepare to close, would you stand with me? So friends, as we go, I just invite you to hear what I believe truly is God's word to you and for you this morning. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Amen and amen. Thanks for being here. I hope you have a wonderful week. We look forward to seeing you next week. He did nothing wrong. They took his crown and cast him down. But little did they know that was meant to be, so we might be with him again. See him at the end, without a veil between, face to face again, all eternity, yeah. So I bend my knees and I've seen
this world.